Can you hear me okay? Great. Well, it's true. I do have a strange fetish for rockets, and only recently with conferences like this can one justify investing in rockets and satellites and drones and robots and everything that's really cool, frankly, if you think about it. When I started in this industry in 95, that was absolutely not the case, right? The IT firms invested in software, computers, semiconductors, and the life sciences people did biotech, and that was pretty much it. You could invest in cars, but you'd lose all your money, right? That was the canonical wisdom ever since Henry Ford. And so a lot of things have changed. What I'll try to share with you is some generalizations from our portfolio and elsewhere on what we're seeing in the hardware space, and also why we don't think of it as hardware. We think of it as sort of an embodiment of software within a bizarre carapace that makes it a different kind of business. It makes it more of a software dynamic. The pace of change, the way in which it disrupts industries, hopefully the capital intensity, although there definitely are some exceptions to that, and that's where we're still learning. But it creates an opportunity that I think is categorically different than perhaps we would have experienced in the 90s. And I'll try to share that with you. So I'll start with, well, actually, I'll go back one. Technology disrupts everything. You know, I can't possibly answer that in just 30 minutes, but I'll try to shed a little bit of thoughts on that. But let me first explain why am I even speaking about this subject. And the reason is that if you think about meaningful change, the kind of stuff that Peter Thiel was talking about earlier this morning, the kind of stuff that history books will be written about, it's always something that comes from a new entrant. So I would maybe frame what you heard this morning in a different way, that it is the most cardinal rule of business I can think of, that large companies never disrupt their core business. So Google will never disrupt search or search advertising. Apple's done nothing innovative in computing in 10 years. But big companies can disrupt new industries. So HP getting into printers, Apple getting into music and the cell phone business, and so forth. But it's mainly entrepreneurs that we focus on here in Silicon Valley. And again, I would say going forward, the companies that will be earning pages in the history books in the future are those that are entering new businesses and disrupting them. Because if they don't have something that's changing the rules of the game, something that's disrupting business as usual, then the big get bigger. You have stasis, stability, and that's what big companies like, right? Whether it's financial crisis, an economic crisis, privatization, globalization, deregulation, new channels of distribution. When things like this come around, it creates opportunities for new playing rules and new games to be played. That creates opportunities for new entrants. If it weren't for that, we wouldn't be having conferences like this. So where does it all come from? You know, I think most of it traces indirectly to technology change, or at least that's the thesis we can continue investing in for the next 10 years. I mean, I could try to look for the next privatization wave, but I can't predict when that's going to happen. I can tell you that Moore's Law is going to likely continue. And this is a photo I took of Gordon Moore. I love it because it literally was just right out there. He grew up in Pescadero, and we were salmon fishing out here, which he still does to this day. And if you go back to his original forecast or statement, in fact, he never said Moore's Law. He's too humble for that. This is from 1965 paper. It's a very geeky axis. It has to do with fab yield optimization for, you know, a wafer fab. And he had 5 data points, and in a very enigmatic way, he said, well, this might just continue forever. And then other people, like Carver Mead, called it Moore's Law. People like George Gilder wrote Microcosm and said, oh my gosh, the semiconductor industry is so unlike anything in history, where over time, miniaturization makes it faster, better, cheaper. As you make these semiconductors, chips, and integrated circuits smaller, the power consumption goes down, the speed goes up. It's almost like magic, as if this was, and it was in a way, something that was never seen before in technology or business, and had people like myself very excited to pursue that as a source of study. Now, what if none of that was true? What if, I didn't do it, that wasn't me, but my computer did, go blank, let's see. Oh, wants me to join the, no, I don't want to join that, thank you very much. Huh, strange. What if it wasn't true? How many people have seen Ray Kurzweil's version of Moore's Law? This is the 110-year version. Actually, if you can keep your hands up for a sec. Really, only 2 hands? 3, okay, 4. Now, Georgianne, I know you've seen it because I show the slide in every presentation I ever give, and I know since you're an LP that you've seen it before. So there's probably maybe 4 or 5 other people that didn't raise their hand. The reason I show it is I used to always say I think it's the most important graph in technology business, and I'm going to keep showing it until all the hands go up in the room. And I've been saying that for 10 years. And I actually would say more now because I'm not getting my point across. I think it's the most important set of data ever graphed. And later in Q&A, I'd love if anyone can think of anything else that's ever been put on a graph of an XY axis that's more important. Now, why is that? X axis is something people actually buy, like computation. It could be storage. You don't buy transistors, so Gordon Moore's thing is not really what anyone thinks about or cares about. They care about, hey, I know, how much compute power can I buy for $1,000? Now, notice the semiconductor era is nothing special, right? It was a refraction of a longer-term trend over 100 years, perhaps going back forever, because we still don't have good data, before the 1890 mechanical devices took the U.S. Census. But every dot's the best price-performance computer of the day. Now, a few takeaways that sort of blow my mind. First, you know, by the way, straight line is an exponential. This is a double exponential. Nobody knew they were on the curve. So you can't argue that people are trying to form fit some forecast the way people sometimes try to explain away Moore's law in the current era, right? Humanity's capacity to compute has compounded for as long as we can measure it. What does that mean? And it's exogenous to the economy. World War I, World War II, Great Depression, right? So for a few things, we continue to invest in molecular electronics, nanotech, quantum computing, things that might extend this curve and not have anything to do with, you know, integrated circuits or CMOS on silicon. And a lot of our nanotech investing focused on that, which is a whole other topic. But it is certainly cause for hope that it might continue, right? If you could bet on anything in technology, it would be hard to think of anything in an era of accelerating change that's more predictable that you could base a future on. And oh, by the way, it starts to explain things like why the MP3 player and the digital music revolution happened when it did, is that when Moore's Law reaches certain tiers of sort of capability, things that weren't digitizable or simulatable become so. And things that may have been trial error experimentation become a digital information science. I think medicine, bioinformatics, and genomics are in the middle of that. So are agricultural biotech and related fields in industrial biotech, which we're actively investing in. So our investment thesis in hardware is, when does Moore's Law reach a point where it's no longer really hardware? When Boeing no longer needs to use wind tunnels to test designs and can do everything with CFD modeling? When is it that genomics and other areas, not in human health because the systems biology is still too tough, but maybe in the areas of making industrial chemicals or other areas are just ripe for a radically new way of doing engineering where you can do millions or billions of experiments in a time period that competitors using older methodologies might do 3 or 4 experiments. And almost everything we invest in benefits from that. We always ask entrepreneurs, why now? Why couldn't this company have been started 5 years ago? And if there's no answer, we don't invest, right? The mere thought that someone had a good idea that went latent and unexploited for 5 years, maybe 10, almost never happens. In fact, there's an argument for why this occurs, perhaps, that I like, which is that every idea is a combination of prior ideas. And so if you think about the set of N ideas, it's combinatorially exploding, and may forever, right? And the sense of future shock and accelerating change may not be anything to do with current technologies. It may just be the long arc of human intelligence and accumulated wisdom, which is kind of profound, almost cosmological. But let's get to something more business-oriented. As those tiers go, these are some of the areas we're currently investing in, and there are many others. In fact, they call it maybe robots and drones today. AI is probably 3 years off for us. I know there are investments in that area already, but we're more interested in deep learning as applied to smaller point solutions as opposed to like literally brain in a box kind of futures. But that will come. Agriculture is a peculiar one. I never would have guessed we'd be investing in that and thinking of it as a software business 10 years ago, but we do. So I'll give some examples, hopefully the colorful and interesting ones. So we love SpaceX just because, I mean, it inspires kids, engineers, and the next generation to care about math and science. And they're just doing really cool stuff. It's just hard to deny it. As I think Paul Allen put it, there's something inherently cool about rocketry, you know, and I think he's right about that. So what's interesting about SpaceX is they want to colonize Mars, as you heard. That was the founding vision of the company. Actually, the founding vision was to put a greenhouse on Mars and then be done. And then the thought was that the governments everywhere would realize if an eccentric millionaire, not even billionaire at that point, could put a greenhouse on Mars, certainly we could have a Mars program. That was the founding vision of SpaceX. The first $100 million came entirely from Elon Musk, because that's an unfundable proposition, right? There's no business concept attached to a greenhouse on Mars, to be clear. It's now very different. There's a whole lot of business. It's been profitable for 6 years in a row. They have approaching now $5 billion of backlog, and then commercial backlog, and they just got another $2.8 billion contract from NASA just a couple weeks ago. Well, their core business today is commercial launch. Don't try to read the chart. Just realize it goes from 1980 to today. The United States in 1980 had 100% market share of commercial launch for a three-year period here. Recently, it had zero, and now with SpaceX, it's coming back. The reason is this is not military spy sats because they are captive to U.S. launch vehicles. If a U.S. satellite company business wants to launch a satellite, there was nothing the U.S. had to offer that was price competitive. All their business went overseas, as did all the international business as well. The U.S. had 0% market share. It just shows you how incredibly messed up that industry was prior to SpaceX coming in and introducing a little bit of competition. They've only done phase one. By the way, Elon only is building rockets because the Russians were yanking him around on the pricing for some ICBMs, these NEPR rockets. And it was, if it weren't for that, he wouldn't be in the rocketry business because that wasn't really what he intended to do at first. He just wants to colonize Mars, however he can get there. But times change, so now they've made a difference already, all that business I mentioned, but phase two is going to be much more interesting. So they are, as you probably know, building reusable rockets. The one on the left shows these white legs folded up against the body. On the right is an unpainted version, person for scale, a carbon fiber leg with a huge helium actuator to put it down, and as it's coming down, it can feather. And this is actually kind of breathtaking. Everyone else in the industry thought this was a fool's errand. You know, good luck, Elon, making this work, which is been theorized since the 60s as an essential step but never succeeded, which is take a rocket as it's going up. You know, the booster has 9 out of 10 engines, about 85% of the cost. It's lost on every flight from every company that's ever launched a rocket. But what SpaceX does instead is turns it around after the rest of the missions and is on its way, fires the engines, comes back to the launch pad, comes around again, comes down propulsively, no parachutes, right? Just, you know. Had it been on land, the very first flight with legs would have been a perfect success, as would have the second and everyone since. It worked the first time when everyone who was in the industry thought it was impossible, which is kind of interesting, right? Since 1969, when Arthur Clarke first identified this as the essential step in rocketry, everyone knew it should be done, no one cared to do it, and they thought it was too hard. It's a testament to simulation, the tools of simulation, on supersonic flight and transonic flight, and to the modular design and reuse that is embedded within the system. Every electronics module, and this is the same FPGA, just running different software, allows for very quick changes in protocols and flight avionics and control systems, because it's all software. They've pulled, just like Apple did with the phone, as much stuff into the software layer as could be done with a generic hardware layer. And it is kind of amazing, because that will lower the cost 10x still. Imagine you threw an airplane away after every one-way flight. Who would fly? Right. It would be weirdos, governments, or combinations of the two, you know. That's pretty much rocketry today, right? Billionaires and governments. And in the future, it should be less for an equivalent flight than flying an airplane, right? And that would be, by equivalent, I mean if you have to go in orbit, I mean flying an airplane around the Earth with the same number of passengers as a rocket going around the Earth with that many passengers, it should be cheaper to do it with a rocket. But it seems so far from where we are today. The Dragon 2 pre-announced, sort of showing what it would likely look like, sort of almost like a nod to Tesla-like design that will be carrying up to 7 astronauts per capsule, and sort of I might call this How to Train Your Dragon 2. It's a sort of look forward to the $2.8 billion crew contract that they just got from NASA. And where would this eventually go, and why is it different from any other crew capsule, whether that be Apollo, Gemini, Mercury, Orion, anyone else you've heard of, is he decided to make it land propulsively. Why? Well, this is a cartoon, this is not a real product announcement on Mars, but if you're gonna land on moons and Mars and other planets, you can't necessarily do it with parachutes. You might wanna land propulsively. It turns out that can also be your escape mechanism on the pad. There's all these ancillary benefits. Just like reusability of the booster, no one thought to invest the energy in that solution unless you're trying to get to Mars. Like, oh, by the way, why did he invest the energy to do the booster? It's so that you could have 100,000 flights to Mars, bringing 1 million people to Mars. Like, the logistics of depreciation of the asset become important there. It isn't important if you're just putting satellites in orbit. In fact, I might say that the reason SpaceX is unlike all the incumbents is that he had a dream that was so big and bold and so far beyond the current industry that he had to chain back from that future vision to the present and think of breakthroughs like reusability that just wouldn't be worth it. You wouldn't overcome that activation energy if all you cared about was lofting low Earth satellites into orbit. Same could be said for Tesla with making all vehicles on the Earth electric. That boldness of vision sometimes changes back to the present to just give passion to the employees, the founders, and others to do things that nobody in the industry would care to do if it's just business as usual. In this particular case, if all I'm doing is launching satellites in low Earth orbit, it's not worth the investment of time and money and risk to do something different, especially if your competitors aren't, you know, milking the government for inefficient prices. Is a great game if you can stay with it and everyone, you know, stays on the same page. By the way, for inspiration, this is what you see when you walk in the front door of SpaceX headquarters. It used to just be a big, big photo of Mars, and now recently they've added one that has Mars terraformed. You know, every employee sees this each day as a reminder of why they come to work. Now, as I mentioned, I launched rockets. Just last month, Elon Musk, his kids, and my kids were out there. My son and I have been out there for 10 years in a row now. This is when we launched a cruise missile booster we buy from a Canadian aerospace company. And there's all kinds of electronics and video cameras and GPS on board. So we've completely lost it when it comes to a hobby gone wild. And there's a bunch of other yahoos out there that do even bigger stuff. In fact, these are other people's rockets. And people build these things in their garage and get to see the thin blue line of space. And it's pretty cool. And a lot of fun. So rather than just a hobby, why did I segue to this other than SpaceX rockets? Well, here's another kind of rocket, is that I met these unusual people out there one day. They were doing all kinds of astrobiology experiments, and they were mumbling all this stuff about the phone as a satellite. They had this, at the time in 2010, fairly new Android HTC phone. And they said, you know, this thing has more processing power, better camera, more memory, and a better six-axis accelerometer than any satellite in orbit. And we've tested it in a vacuum and under radiation experiments. We think if you just lofted this phone into orbit, it would be symbolically a better satellite than anyone else is flying, you know, at the $500 million to $1 billion price points per satellite. Now, of course, it doesn't last very long. It doesn't have propulsion. It's missing a lot of things. There's a reason why the average satellite is the size of a school bus. But the point, and these are all a bunch of NASA folks, was there's a new era coming upon. And this is sort of an example I'll use symbolically for what is this new era of hardware? How is it you take something that was such a bad, capital-intensive, crappy business, if you look at the multiples in the public market for any of the companies that participate in this business, and turn it into something that feels like software? And I'll tell you a little bit about that story, but I think it's emblematic of similar stories going on in robotics, drones, and such. So we're stress testing it with this huge rocket that the Rocket Mavericks group and we were launching, and they wanted to test just the G load of launch. Could it take the vibration and acceleration and shock, which is a little harder to test on the ground. And oh boy, did we give them a test, because it came back ballistic. In fact, at Maker Faire this year, I saw they still have the foam sat that we just drilled into the desert, supersonic speeds. Yet they got the SD card back, got the data, and proceeded to then develop and launch three of these foam sats from the International Space Station. The people involved, though, I've been keeping track with them, and they started a startup in a garage, which we have now invested in full disclosure. It's called Planet Labs, and this is their satellite. Not a model, that's the satellite, and you get a sense of size. It has a commercial off-the-shelf telescope and all of the electronics that would be in that cell phone or in the little corners of the device, and in a sense, just like the the drones and the robots and satellite companies, they are the beneficiary of what I think Chris Anderson aptly called the peace dividend of the cell phone wars. So when Apple and Samsung are beating each other up, the prices of those components are so darn cheap that they can build satellites four orders of magnitude more cheaply than the incumbents. Now, why do they do this? I'll show you in a moment. It's not just making smaller, better, cheaper. There's an interesting advantage they get. First, they can test these things. They can test them in airplanes. They can throw them up in all kinds of sort of hitchhiking into space. The very first images we were downloading using the Stanford dish, which was a lot of fun. That's one of their dishes in Europe. And this was the very first picture they took. It was in Oregon. And what was interesting and symbolic of where they're heading with their business is, when you compare it to the equivalent Google Earth image, there's a dramatic amount of change, right? There's been deforestation already, probably legal in this case, that you just don't get, because the Google Earths and maps of the world are looking at urban centers on a fairly frequent basis, but they don't cover the whole Earth and they don't see it on any kind of reasonable basis. So if you're trying to track a disaster zone like Fukushima, no one was looking there prior to the nuclear disaster, or if there's been a tornado, or if there's illegal deforestation, you're just not getting data in real time. What Planet realizes is that if you fly a inexpensive lens close to Earth, you get just as good a picture as a huge expensive telephoto lens far away. If the satellite's cheap enough that you don't mind it deorbiting within a year, you can just think of them as disposable satellites. You put up a new one each year, and you put up 100 in a single launch, again, 100 times cheaper than a single big satellite, and you image the entire Earth every day. So the capability they're releasing this year is the ability to image every meter of the Earth every day. So think about this from a commodities trading point of view. What's the health of every wheat crop globally, corn, soybean, everywhere on the planet every day? Or if you're tracking retail sales, count every car in every retail parking lot of Walmart versus competitors every day. It's an algorithm, right? No humans counting those. You just look at all the data. It's a torrent of data that will be coming down. And there already are companies that are monitoring industrial output in China daily using these proxies. If you wanted to do something humanitarian, monitor conflict zones or the press to look at what's happening around the world, you have a degree of transparency and awareness of the planet. You also have the ability, again, catch deforestation while it's happening or illegal fishing while it's happening, same day imagery. These are the flocks, they just built tons of these things, right? 28 when their first launch. They now launched a lot of these, and they come from beautiful places. You get to see them coming out of the space station, something that really is an unusual perspective in the sense of scale difference is reminded here in the ISS arrays. Think of them as a software company, right? In the last 15 months, they've launched on 6 different rockets, 71 satellites, more than all of the companies combined in Earth observation in history, as well as in any industry in the last few years. And they build a new physical hardware design every 6 weeks. That's like a software company, right? They actually have spent more on their website than their hardware, which is just give you a sense of how overpaid for the website. Planet.com, a little bit of an expensive URL, felt very .com-y 1999, but nevertheless. And they see things as it happens. I mean, a fire breaking out within 10 minutes, right, before the news even caught it. That's the kind of thing they're going to enable. And it could affect a lot of businesses. So if I step back for a moment, our investment in SpaceX, realizing the cost of access to space is going to come down, informed our investment in satellite companies to say, how will that industry transform? And then the big data cloud services, if you will, that are going to build on top of this, what are all the other investments that are going to make use of this data stream and all the proxies off this data stream, or all the sort of metadata off these image streams that one could have? That's sort of how we think about investing over time in a sector that really isn't a category. We're not looking for another rocket company We're not certainly looking for another Earth imaging company. We probably would consider a broadband internet, but not from satellite, which will be coming, but not this exact thing. So it's not a category, like Peter said. It's more a series of steps of capabilities as things transform. And in summary, this example, I think, transcribes to the other ones I'll show you much more briefly, is that, what changed? Why now? Why not 5 years ago? Well, certainly cheaper access to space, SpaceX, and et cetera. Simulation tools save them a ton of time. Commodity hardware, cell phone wars. Dematerialization of value. In a sense, where is the value in this company? Just like other new satellite imaging companies that are forming, they're going to tell you it's the software and services layer, not the hardware. And, of course, they can tap into global markets like never before. This is kind of interesting, right? It's a lot easier in this era of the internet, we sometimes take it for granted, to sell globally. Their biggest customer right out of the chute was in China, a huge customer. Well, it's sort of neck and neck with a large U.S. company, but no, China might be bigger. Over the next 4 years, it might be a larger single customer than the U.S. one. And they call it Agile Aerospace. Now, this generalizes. There's all kinds of other examples. We haven't invested in these ones, but a lot of them are using 3D printing and investment casting to create satellites where essentially complexity comes for free. So all the mounts for this particular satellite and all the things that need to be precisely aligned come for free because it's a 3D print that then, is used in a sacrificial ceramic mold to create a titanium hull, which is the fuel tank for, in that case of Planetary Resources, a telescope. In the case of Moon Express, a lunar lander. Yeah, and interestingly, both companies ended up on the same exact concept, using 3D printing to create a torus, to hold fuel, to land, which is kind of bizarre convergent evolution of ideas. Robots and drones, you're going to hear from Drone Deploy soon after me, one of our investments. And Rodney Brooks of MIT, also with Baxter, has, as you saw, a really interesting idea of robots that are kind of like the Apple II of robots, where you program them by moving the arms. My son programmed the one that we bought on a whim. So first, buying a robot on a whim, an industrial robot that you pull out of a box, plug in the 110, and kids can program it, and you don't even know what you're going to use it for, that's like the Apple II. And the price point is about the same in current dollars if you took a fully loaded Apple II versus one of these. And the whole point is, anywhere you have a person in a sedentary position doing a job they absolutely hate, you can drop one of these in. Because, feeding one conveyor belt to another. Unfortunately, even at Amazon, there are people that do insane jobs like this all day long, like a robot. And if it feels like a robot, just use a robot. Their biggest customer uptake is in China. You just heard that in one of the earlier panels about how the robots are actually making sense in Korea and China and in those areas that we thought of as, if you will, sweatshops of labor. It's no longer the case. My favorite robots are the autonomous cars. I'm hoping my kids never need to drive. I really believe that will be the case. Eventually available to all, but in the near term, hopefully, unless legal really stifles progress at companies like this. But for regulatory hurdles that haven't yet arisen. Right, so no current hurdles, but unless a new hurdle arises, I believe that's a doable proposition. And I absolutely believe, having been behind the wheel of this 3 times now, that even 3 years ago, this Google autonomous car is better than my parents. And I would trust that car to drive my kids more than my parents. My parents still drive my kids, and it scares the bejesus out of me. It's like old people backing up. Like, I'm not going to look over my shoulder because it hurts. Like, my dad just, oh, my God. He still has his driver's license, and I can't wait to hand it over to one of these. And this is interesting because I think it will transform the fabric of society when you don't need to own a car, when you don't need parking, when you spend 40% of your time in the average city looking for parking. And you'll see the major automotive companies introducing incremental improvements, as they should, along cruise control theses and automatic parallel parking, and then that'll just generalize to automatic parking. And this is a way for them not to radically change the, in a sense, insurance norms that we have around who's liable if an accident occurs. So if you are an existing car company, you want to be really careful about radical change in this regard, as opposed to just slow change. So it's normal. I think that's what you'll see. I'm not sure if there's anything I want to say about Tesla other than when we talk about building things and hardware, I do like some of the various earliest comments that came out around this vehicle that America still can make things. I think a lot of people have sort of lost faith in that for whatever reason. And we can. So I don't think I'll say anything else there other than, just like all the other companies, software and simulation helps. You don't need to really bump off a bunch of crash test dummies. You know how the crash tests generally are going to go before you do it. And that's why it, as you probably saw, did better than any car ever tested. It's kind of interesting. I mean, it even broke the test equipment for side impact, right? You're supposed to simulate hitting a telephone pole sideways. And you're supposed to keep pushing the telephone pole into the car till it yields by some number of inches. And you're supposed to find that point. So it sets a world record. Eventually the test equipment broke before the car yielded, which is kind of amazing. So no other car company says they're the safest car made, because every other car company has a bunch of cars. And so if they have one that's the safest, the rest aren't. So you just kind of say, oh, it's all five-star. They've always known where they are in that five-star. They actually know the exact number, like the fourth safest car, the 12th safest car, all five-star. It was number one. I don't think I'll talk about this, other than it's really cool, that you can use software to guide little vanishingly small pulses of light, each of which have more energy than the entire U.S. electrical grid, to machine things without any heat. They literally dissociate atoms into subatomic particles, and so there's no burning. You can cut through tissues of your body or match heads, plastics, glass, like Gorilla Glass and such. And it just gives yet another, we sometimes invest in tools that help enable a whole bunch of new making of things in a cheaper way. So let me just share one or two more examples, and I'm seeing I'm 26 minutes in. I think I'm supposed to only go for 30. So let me skip this one just to say this is really weird. I mean, if it works, it'll be amazing. I'm on the board, so I'll admit I want it to work, and I give it still maybe a 10% chance of fully fulfilling its potential, which is to build computers that engage the resources of more than one universe. That's an interesting point of differentiation and competition. In fact, David Deutsch of Oxford put it best, that this may be the only example you can think of, or at least that's in development, that allows you to engage the resources of parallel universes, and that's really weird and really useful. And what it's being used for, actually for about 8 years now, by Google, is even as early as 2009, they realized it outperforms their entire data center for machine learning and deep learning tasks. This is basically what Google does throughout all their advanced research stuff. It's how they power speech recognitions, document translation, anything that feels a little bit magical. Actually, anything you see in the next 10 years that feels a little bit magical when it first comes out is probably based on machine learning. And they believe that it's literally the best the possible architecture for using it. I'm going to skip all the bio stuff. I apologize, because I spent a little longer than I wanted to. But basically, there's a whole nother, if anyone wants to talk about it, basically agricultural and industrial chemical angle that we could think of as hardware, but I'm not sure if people really do think of that in the same way, so I'm not sure if people in the room are interested in it, but we invest in a bunch of companies that are trying to basically address the issue that, you know, in the next 50 years we have to grow more food than since the beginning of the invention of agriculture. That's a big challenge. We will do it. It'll be GMOs or things that sort of punk the EU by not really being a GMO by their rules, but like Kaima is a great example. They double the DNA in every plant, literally. The seeds have, as if you had four parents instead of two, your recessed genes are more recessed, you express the archetype of your species, the plants go faster with less vulnerability, but it's not considered a GMO in Europe because it has no new nucleotides. It's the formality they have. So it's open field tests in Israel and throughout Europe, and hopefully we can save Europe from themselves and their policies. I mean, to be fair, the European regulators realize they need GMOs, they just can't change the law, so they have to figure out how to use the laws that exist and still have GMOs. And they're doing it all over the place. I mean, it's really hilarious. Some of the things they're doing with microbial seed coatings and others. Okay, so one last theoretical point as I end. So when we think about designing, let's say, algae or bacteria to make chemicals in ways that hadn't been done before, or we're trying to do something really interesting in robotics and AI, or if you're just trying to build an innovative organization and exploit the wisdom of crowds effect, which may sound all very different, but in all cases, you're trying to build a complex system that largely exceeds human understanding in many ways. What goes beyond what any human could understand. We've long since designed things that are understandable. We're now actually engineering artifacts through different modalities like deep learning and neural networks that exceed human understanding. They're more of an iterative algorithm, more like parenting than engineering, and they're very powerful. I'll give you just one example. One of our companies, Genomatica, wanted to make this chemical that is not made in nature using a microbe from a feedstock that's pretty darn cheap, waste sugar. And one team, the purposeful Germanic engineering approach, said we're going to use our simulation tools, right back to simulation, and model all of 40,000 different ways to get from A to B, including pathways that don't exist in nature and the ones that do, and optimize for carbon yield, ATP cycle, all the things that, you know, biochemists care about. And they got about a fivefold improvement in the yield of a chemical in that design effort. A parallel team did artificial evolution. What they said is, let me find some path purposefully, thinking ahead of time about this whole was about to follow, that gets me from A to B. We're making this chemical is a byproduct of the organism's survival, and then selectively cripple all of the redundant pathways that that organism has, because it normally could eat many different things, and it normally doesn't want to squirt out a chemical that has nothing to do with its own survival, but they crippled it selectively. And they just skimmed the fastest growers for 3 months. Whatever's growing the fastest and mutating like crazy, because these things reproduce every 20 minutes and mutate, they reproduce every 20 minutes and mutate each cycle. By the end, they had a 20,000-fold improvement in yield. So 5x from design, 20,000x, sort of intelligent design, if you will, 20,000x from directed evolution. The things you build through this process, you don't understand why or how they work, but you understand the process of their creation, and that's the most important takeaway from that modality of, you know, shifts from product learning to process learning. And I think that's summarizing this last quote from Danny Hillis on a computer science book, that where we really are in engineering is thinking of new ways of building things, new tools, new, and I would put deep learning in this category, that allow us to create more than we can understand. So I'll end it with that. What I tried to share with you is that we are in an era of accelerating technological change and are likely to continue to be so. That's not something you should expect to change. That sort of sense of future shock will be perpetual. That sort of IT or the information technology will eventually transform all industries over time. They will become IT businesses in the sense of how do you compete with your competitors? It's the use of IT, not the use of labor, not the use of capital, not the use of any particular invention or product. It's going to be IT. And that'll lead to more black swans in the Nicholas Taleb sense. I took this photo of a black swan metaphorically drinking from a fire hose. That's my sort of image of the future. And this is therefore a great time for the new, the small, the new entrant, big companies getting into new industries, smaller economies, competing on a global scale like never before, and most provocatively, the next 3 billion people who come online in 6 years. So, right, in the next 6 years, there are 3 billion humans currently not on the internet who are going to join the internet via smartphones and global broadband. That is unprecedented in human history, either in sheer numbers or as a percentage of the global population. They're all going to have access to online education. They're all going to have access to entrepreneurial opportunities. They could compete for our best programming jobs. And it's going to transform the world like nothing we've ever seen before. So if there's nothing I've shared today, it's perhaps a framework to set up for, oh my gosh, let that tsunami of innovation, of ideas cross-pollinating on a global basis, and entrepreneurship and innovation like we've never seen before. So that makes it an exciting time to be an investor in technology. Thanks.